We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws, we enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I am your host, Dave Bourne, and it is July 7th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show, or a couple minutes after, give it a couple minutes to upload on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, as well as by the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom. Exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we, of course, are always happy to hear from you. You can call in at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request with your name and what you want to talk about. And check us out at Nonpartisan Liberty for All, which has all the links to our Facebooks and other social media, as well as contact information, articles, and blogs. The archives are also posted every weekend. Right now, as I've been mentioning, I'm working on a series related to the legalization of drugs. I'm up to part 4 in that series, and I hope to add to it in the near future, but that's going to be a long series because there are so many aspects to cover when it comes to the war on drugs and why drugs should be illegal like they were before 1920. Now, today I wanted to talk about something we've actually sort of never talked about. So we've talked about police violating the freedoms of people and, of course, murdering them. But I've never focused on criminal cops. And I would say that violating people's freedoms and murdering them is criminal activity. But when I say criminal cops, I'm talking about cops that sell drugs or cops that rob banks or any that they're committing crime either while on the job, or I was going to say while they're on active duty or on the side, that they're committing other crimes at that time as well. So it's similar but different. I had talked a little about this yesterday and kind of previewed what we were going to talk about today and talked about the difference with Ken Shorgen of the Daily Economist, as he's on the show every other Wednesday and he happened to be on. So we got a little into that conversation, but we got into a whole nother conversation. But my question to him, and we kind of got off on something else, was, do you look at those cops the same way? Do you look at one worse than the other? And in some ways, I look at the cops that shoot people and violate people's rights and treat people like shit but don't commit crimes as doing more damage than the criminal cops that are selling drugs or robbing drug dealers or doing that stuff. Now, a lot of times it crosses over where you have they're doing both. And then that's, of course, the worst of all cops is a cop that does both. But it seems that a lot of the cops that are violating people's rights and killing people aren't necessarily doing the other things, or maybe they are and we just don't know about it, or at least to that extent. We haven't ever really heard from the cops that have done the rights violations come out and speak about it, because they never end up getting convicted. The cops that commit crimes are the ones that end up coming out and speaking about it, because they end up going to jail and then they come out and a lot of them are, well, at least say, well, I shouldn't have done this and this is what I did and whatnot. And that's the difference, is it seems like the cops that they go after are the ones that commit these crimes, not the ones that violate rights. And if I had a choice in who they went after, I'd rather them go after the ones that kill people. And I'm not talking about killing people as in a cop that kills for a drug dealer that actually kills another drug dealer or something like that, that type of thing, which is worse in a way because it's premeditated murder. But I'm talking about the cops that kill people that, you know, that are running away or at when they pull them over, that they usually never get convicted. And they are, even when they do, they believe they're in the right. And so you never hear from them. Now, I was going to 100% focus or, you know, 98% focus on criminal cops. But because of what's happened in the past, at least day or couple days, I feel that I have to put some things in perspective regarding the cops that are shooting and killing people. And there's so many things that go into this that just make it so horrible, not to mention the distortion by the media. Now, first of all, one of the things that happens is they only focus, of course, on cops killing certain people because, number one, there's about 4 people a day that get killed by cops. It's just a fact. Now, it could be a little more because that's based on tracking of reporting by independent sources like killed by police, but I'm sure they miss some. So then you factor that in, that they're going to miss some. Some are not going to be reported. And I'm sure there are still police that kill people and get rid of the bodies. I would not be surprised at all. Now, is that the criminal cop that is doing a hit on somebody, or is it a cop that, oh shit, I accidentally beat this person and I'm just going to get rid of the body? I'm sure you have both, but I'm referring more to the person, the cop that beat somebody and they end up dying for some reason and they're able to do it in an area or in a situation where nobody else sees it and they bury the body somewhere. So that, I'm sure, happens not that often, but what I've come to is, I believe last year was something like 1,400. It might have been a little less. This year it's on pace based on killed by police, because we've been through about half a year, to be about 1,200. So I took 1,400 and, you know, divide by 365. So, and you got an extra day this year because of leap year. And if you round it, because it comes out to like 3.8, it comes out to about 4 people a day. Now, being fair, because I do this with people that are killed by guns, So, or anything for that matter. So I should be fair when I talk about people killed by cops, that, okay, what's that in the percentage of interactions or whatever? It's not a high percentage. However, you're talking about a totally different thing, where if one person a day even died by police that was unarmed, that is a serious problem, even though in relation to the amount of interactions police have with people, it's probably a small percentage. But when you're talking about your government killing people, it doesn't matter if it's 1% or a half of a percent. It's not the same thing at all, in my opinion. That's why it makes a huge difference. Now, if you say, you know, 1% of people that are murdered or killed by guns or something like that, or 1% of deaths or something. It's not 1% of murders, but it's less than 1% of all deaths are by guns. It's a tiny percentage. It's like it's not even 1%. It's like a 50th of a percent or something along those lines. So if you take those four people, now granted, not every single one of those are unwarranted. However, I would say the only warranted shooting by a police officer is when they're being shot at. And someone has to pull the trigger on them first. And I keep talking about the Detroit Threat Management Center. For those that are listening that haven't heard of them, you should look them up. The Detroit Threat Management Center, I think that's their – I kind of always mess up their name there and put an extra word in. But I believe it's the Detroit Threat Management Center. I had the owner who started with a shotgun and a dog. I have a lot of respect for that guy, even though he was supposed to come back on the show. It didn't get back to me. But I needed to – I only followed up, I think, once, and I should have – I'll follow up again with him in the future because he was a really good interview as well. And I talked to him for about 2 hours after and about an hour before he, you know, not an hour before the show, but an hour as a pre-interview at least. It might have been 2 hours then, too. I mean, he's a really interesting guy to talk to. He has so many stories. I mean, stuff he's like, Dave, there's stuff I can't tell you that, you know, I need to write a book when I retire because there's so much shit that I know that has to do with the police that I can't say. And he still gave a lot of information. But what they do is they focus on protection. So they're a security company that focuses on protecting people with the least amount of force or the least amount necessary to defuse the situation. And they used to be armed. As of 2015, they are no longer armed with guns. They're armed with other stuff. I don't know what they're using now. But as of 2015, they stopped carrying guns. Now, I would say, you know, I would want to carry a gun, to be honest. But their rule was they would not shoot at someone unless they were shot at. And you could say, well, they weren't facing the same stuff the police were. No, they are. They do the same stuff. Some of the stuff they do is even more dangerous because they do actual, you know, in-home protection and things like that, or where they're actually protecting somebody. So if someone has been threatened where they have someone that's planning on coming after them with a gun, that's a threat they have to deal with. A lot of it is in training. It's not just in training. It's in the mentality. It's in from the top down. And it's also the fact that they're held accountable. They know that they can't just shoot people and kill them and get away with it like police can. They know that they have to maintain customer service because people don't have to hire them. So it's a free market solution, and they do a lot of work where if you can't afford them, they help people for free. They protect people for free. Whereas they have a lot of contracts with businesses. And of course, they have to give that customer service, not just to the business, but they can't just assault somebody acting as security because the business could be sued. It's not like the police. So they have their standard is so much higher. So that's one of the reasons, besides the fact that they don't want to hurt anybody. I mean, that's not their goal. But they would not shoot at somebody unless they were shot at. And they were trained to deal with those situations. And if you're not trained to deal with those situations, you have no business being out there. So my rule in general, and again, this is in general because if there's some exceptions, if a guy is an inch away from you with a knife about to, you know, stab you in your heart and somehow you're able to, shoot him and that's your only option or something. But there is stun guns. There are other, but I'm sure there's very obscure, 0.1% of the time or something like that where something like that could happen, and I would agree with it. Besides that, I don't. Now, if someone is shooting at a cop, directly shooting at a cop, I'm not talking about shooting in the air neither, then they have the right, if they're being shot at, I think, to shoot back. But even in those situations, they should do their best to avoid killing that person, which obviously they don't do. So on a daily basis, and this is just from a sample that I took of about 50 people, it might have been a little more, maybe 60, that were killed by the police, all races, because all races are killed by police, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And the issue is really getting distorted, which really bothers me, because the issue is the police and their power. It's not, race. Although I will say that there are more black people getting killed by police than white people, percentage-wise, not numbers-wise, because they make up a smaller percentage of the population. But yes, there are more. But of course, how many people does the majority of the majority of Americans know got killed by police this year or heard about? And they probably heard about a couple of the last 2 days, and that's probably about it. Maybe they heard about two or three more at the most. Maybe they heard five at the most. And it depends where you live, because if it's locally, you're going to hear about it in your local area if you watch the news. But I'm talking about nationally. So I'm talking about people that were killed by police that weren't killed in your city. So I think most people at the most would say five. And they might not even say that many when you're talking about 600. So based on my, this is just my findings and my opinion based on those findings. And you could say, well, I have a biased opinion, and that's fine. But I would say that at minimum, one unarmed person per day is killed. The majority, no doubt, I would say, if we're talking about four people a day being killed, that three of them should not have lethal force should not have been used, because they might have had a knife, they might have had something like that, but they didn't have a gun. And they weren't shooting at police. And some days it may be all of them. But you don't hear about those. You only hear about certain killings. And that's only recently. Some people thought police didn't really kill anybody until like Ferguson. Before that, they thought, oh yeah, like one or two people a year get killed by the police or something. Or only people that shoot at police get killed by the police. Like in movies when they say, you know, drop the gun. They don't say drop the gun. They're shooting at you. So, because their motto is they want to go home safe. And I read a quote before from Radley Balko's book, and I strongly suggest you read it, The Rise of the Warrior Cop, of a cop who actually had said that, no, it's not you going home safe. It's everybody else going home safe. That's your job, is to make sure everybody else goes home safe. Not that you go home safe is last. And if you don't accept that, then don't be a police officer. So the issue I have is that there, and it's all, I think, being manipulated by progressive operatives and things like that, where they're making it look like it's only black people that are killed by police. And granted, I'm not going to deny that. I believe the government is the most racist organization and the one who generates that oppression. So police are part of government. I believe that a lot of police stations are racist in general, or racist might not be the correct term, but they discriminate, or they discrimination might not even be the word there, but they label black people as criminals. So they're prejudiced, or because they prejudge. So I think it's more being prejudiced more than anything. And I think it also has to do with the neighborhood you're in and how you're dressed and things like that. I think that factors into it as well. And people are going to say that it doesn't. And it shouldn't, just because somebody's dressed a certain way or lives in a certain area. But it's more, I think, in areas that are predominantly black. And I've talked about this before. Not every black person lives in a black community. I believe it's either even or more black people don't live in all black communities. In major cities, most of the areas are mixed. And I know if you look at the stats of Las Vegas, of how many black people, the percentage of black people in Las Vegas, and we have a high percentage of Hispanic population, but it's not that high. But I mean, everywhere I live in, I think, a pretty good area and always have. And there are a lot of black people that I see in my neighborhood, and Hispanic people. And of course, I mean, my fiance is Mexican. So it's all mixed, really, in most of the areas. There is a couple areas that are all black or all white or all Hispanic within Las Vegas. But then the rest of it is pretty mixed. Now, it might be not mixed evenly, but it is pretty mixed. So, but my point is that, yes, I think the police in general, they definitely kill black people at a higher rate. They definitely prejudge black people. And I think that's why they end up shooting more, because they're scared that every black person's a criminal, which is, I don't know if you'd call that racist as opposed to prejudice. Because racist, I would say there's hate there. And I think the word racist is thrown around, because to me, racist has to do with hate. The word discrimination is pretty easy to define. It's discriminating against somebody. Is you won't hire someone because they're black. It's actually acting on your racist or prejudice thoughts, where you won't be around somebody because they're black, or you won't be around somebody because they're, I mean, it everybody does it to some level because they're fat. You won't date fat girls, or you won't whatever. That's discrimination. And everybody has the right to discriminate in their personal life. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that as long as you're not hurting anybody. If you're not physically or, you know, going out and verbally harassing people or anything like that, I think it matters when it comes to not hiring somebody. Although I don't believe the government should be involved in what businesses do. I think it's up to the business owner. However, if a business owner didn't want to hire people, black people, hated black people, I wouldn't want to go to that business. So I'd want to know that. And you would know that if business owners were allowed to do what they wanted. But of course, the government steps in and says, well, you have to hire based on this, this, and this. And I, you know, there's so many things that have gone on throughout history. And you could say, well, this, it's hard to say that, well, things should be a certain way when all these other things are a certain way. So, like, I would say we should get rid of government police. They should not exist. And people would say, well, then there'd be total chaos and stuff like that. Well, no, then you'd have private security companies and all of that. But you'd have to set that up as well. So if you didn't set that up, what I'm saying is for things to be one way, you have to change a bunch of other things as well. Otherwise, it's not going to work out the way it should in a free society. But what bothers me is that I said before that essentially, to me, I'm about freedom for everybody. So if it doesn't matter the race or the sexual orientation or whatever you want to bring into it, I believe in freedom. And if freedom, real true freedom and liberty, not the bullshit freedom that progressives are trying to say that everybody has the right to health care, to force people to do things for them, to force to ban guns because everyone has the right for other people not to have guns so they can be safe. Like bullshit that they twist around like that. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about true freedom, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you don't hurt anybody or steal from somebody. I believe in freedom for everyone. And the problem is that they are only focusing on the police that kill black people in the government media, because that's what they want to do, I think, because they want to federalize the police, because what that will do is give the government an army. And the police basically have been federalized, and it's the federal government that has trained police to be more trigger happy, trust me. So it's like, I've said this a million times. They caused the problem, and then they're telling people like they're going to solve it. The same people that caused it in the first place, which is people like Obama and his predecessor, Bush. So, and all of the people that are part of their administration. And again, they do get killed at a higher percentage. But to just focus on black people being killed by police, you're missing the point, because what people are saying is that, okay, well, if police just weren't prejudiced or racist or whatever word they want to use, I would say prejudice, then the problem would be solved. And no, it wouldn't. The problem is that the police have too much power. And I think most people know that it's not a race issue, in that they couldn't get away with what they got away with if they didn't have the power that they had. So when I say it's not a race issue, what I'm saying is that somehow changing the view of police or stopping police from lowering the amount of black people that are killed by police is somehow going to lower the total amount of people that police kill or solve the problems that we have with police, it's not going to happen. The real issue is that police have too much power. They have more power than normal people, which if you really look at it, it is unconstitutional. You can't have a fair but equal system. And really, as I've said before, because they have a monopoly on force, they have no incentive to improve. They have no incentive to improve customer service or be better or to do their jobs better. None. So I don't focus on race. I focus on freedom. And it's regardless of what races, you know, freedoms are being oppressed by the government, although I would say I do agree that the government oppresses black people and minorities' freedoms a lot more, especially in the court system. I think a lot of black people get screwed over in the court system. I really do. And I think in general, people get screwed over in the court system. And the problem is the court system. But what the government media and progressive operatives are trying to do is, one, divide people, and two, turn the problem into something else. Make it about race so you can divide people and the solutions are different. Because to me, the solution is legalized drugs, for one, or, you know, go back to how they were before the 20s, because that's a whole bunch of crimes that police can't fuck with you for. And search, they have no need to pull you over. They have no need to search you. That would be one. And, of course, end the police and get rid of their power and change the whole fucking justice system to where the government, it's not in the government's favor the way it is. So that would be my opinion. And to get there, I've talked about noncompliance and self-defense and things like that. But to just focus on one side, that, oh, well, this race is being affected, but really they're being affected more. But everybody's being affected. But they are being affected more. But focusing on it from a racial standpoint is not going to solve the problem, because it's not going to get to the root of the problem. The root of the problem is the system. The system allows cops. They allow. Now, we talked about this yesterday. I mean, you can't just blame cops. Not that I'm taking the blame away from cops, because they're just as culpable as anybody else. But the politicians that make the laws, the district attorneys who prosecute people and let the cops get away with this shit, you know, all the police at higher levels, police chiefs, lieutenants, whatever. So that's really what they're doing. And that's why you only see certain murders by police on TV. Anytime a cop gets shot, it's a national, not shot, but killed, it's a national story. And I believe last year, it was under 40, like maybe it was 35, something like that, or 39 cops that were actually killed by other people. And most of them were, or a lot of them were, they were chasing, like, you know, known criminals in those circumstances, where they want to blame a lot of that stuff now on people that stand up for freedom and people like me and, you know, that would never do something like that just to do something like that. But whatever. And there's not a threat. They want to claim there's a war on police and all this bullshit. And if you criticize, but they're like little fucking babies. They really are. But it also allows the police to look at it from a different perspective as well and just say, oh, yeah, it's just, you know, these people over here, instead of everybody uniting together to stand up, to not comply with these bullshit laws and to get rid of the police altogether. And when I say get rid of the police, I don't mean kill them. I mean get rid of the institution. And not have government police, have a system like they have something, you know, based on the system in Detroit. So because of what's happened the last few days, I definitely had to bring that up. But now I want to focus on criminal cops, because this is something that I've never really talked about. Like I said, I've talked about cops that are still criminal cops in the sense that they kill people, they violate people's rights. I talk about that all the time. And I got to a point where I was even doing a show a week on it, but it was just the same shit over and over again. I still wanted to keep it in people's faces, but at the same time, I'm sure people are just like, yep, they just keep doing the same thing. You know, why am I going to listen to the same thing over and over again? Because it really was like the same story over and over again. Police kill this unarmed person, you know, every day or every show. It definitely was every day. But I mean, as far as from my perspective, it was every Thursday when I did End the Government Police Thursdays. It was the same type of story. And it's how many times, you know, does that do anything? Does that get people to listen? Because really, it's getting the message out to people. Or do they just say, you know, all right, I keep listening to this on Thursdays and it's just the same fucking shit over and over again. So I stopped doing that. But at the same time, I will never get away from, you know, any opportunity I have to get that in there and to talk about the police. And I also have a Facebook page and the government police, and that's where I put stories about the police. I mean, anything you can think of has been done, and you don't know who's listening that day neither. So that was part of the reason too. But for now, I thought I'd go another direction, maybe when Thomas Woody, who was helping me out with and the Government Police Thursdays, comes back. Maybe we'll have a segment where we talk about stories for the week so everybody stays informed. But it's really just the same stories over and over again. But we might have talked about a story or two about criminal cops, but never really focused on them. So what had happened is I didn't realize how big this documentary was. And I'm finding out as I see this guy on all these podcasts and see all these interviews with him. There was a documentary that came out in 2015. I saw it on somewhere on cable. I had come across it. So it was already an hour into it, so I DVR'd it. And then I watched it. It's called the 175. The 175 was a police department in New York, East New York, partially, I believe, Brooklyn, and the rest East New York. I'm not familiar with East New York. I know New York is set up with the five boroughs, and there's other parts in New York, but I'm not a New York expert when it comes to the geography of New York. But anyway, near there is the 177, which they talk about in this documentary. Was also a corrupt station where I think about 10 cops had got arrested during the same time a lot of this stuff was going on. So the documentary focuses, although it talks about a lot of other officers, and it at the end says how 70 cops were under investigation and 30 left. I don't know how many ended up being prosecuted. But you see this difference here, how they don't go after the cops that are using force, excessive force, or treating people like shit, or violating their rights in a way where they're not, you know, doing crimes after they do that. But when they commit crimes, and I don't know about now, because the ones I came across are all pretty old. And I'm going to talk about a few. The main one I'm going to talk about is Michael Dowd of the 175, who's been on a bunch of shows, and I have a lot of information on him because I've listened to, you know, four or five different interviews that he's done along with the documentary. So he, of course, is the main focus, but there's a couple other cops that I'm going to talk about as well. And this is something that, again, you don't hear a lot about it. I mean, they did this documentary. I'm sure it was a big story in New York at the time. I don't remember. I mean, I was in high school when he went to jail. He ended up going to jail for 12 years. And I don't remember hearing about it, which doesn't really mean anything. I didn't really watch a lot of news back then. So I'm sure it was a pretty big story. But what I think pushed them to make the documentary, why they ended up making the documentary, is because this guy's personality, and it's interesting. But what's kind of disturbing, and I almost see myself doing this as well, like people are almost rooting for this guy, and he is a very likable guy. The one thing, though, I can say about him is he wasn't, at least from what he's said, he wasn't the other side. He wasn't both. He wasn't a cop who violated other people's rights. He violated drug dealers. Not that it's okay, because I think drugs should be legal, but he violated mostly criminals. Although, again, I don't feel that drug dealers are criminals. However, most of the drug dealers that he was dealing with also had people killed. So that I consider criminal. So it doesn't sound like he didn't want from, and this is from what he says. Now, who knows, that he didn't like arresting people. He didn't like giving tickets. He had talked about even giving fake tickets, like, to, because he had to meet a quota and show that he gave tickets, like, with the names weren't real. I mean, so if that's true, I mean, really, he's like, I hardly got any arrest because he wasn't arresting anybody. So on that side of it, I look at that more as a positive, of course. And that's what kind of, you know, when he talks about that stuff, that makes me look at him in a positive light. However, he still had the code of, you know, if one of his partners, you know, did something like that, he's not going to snitch on them. He's not going to tell on them for stuff like that, for violating people's rights. And I think that's more important than a cop stealing money that they're just going to seize anyway. So I think a cop, you know, sending somebody to jail that shouldn't be going to jail, or beating somebody up, or obviously killing them because they're using excessive force, worse than the majority of things that he did. And just to summarize before we get into some detail, and I'm going to jump around to some other people, but he protected drug dealers. He at one point sold drugs, or had people sell drugs for him. He said he sold drugs and had four clients, but he also got drugs and then had somebody else, him and his partner had somebody else sell for him. It was actually his partner's connection. And that ended up getting them and leading to them getting in trouble. And he protected drug dealers, would collect pay from them, tip them off. He would go bust the guys he wanted them to bust. He says he never killed anybody. He never had anything to do with that. But he did hand over someone who robbed a drug dealer over to that drug dealer. And that person, they don't come out and say that he killed him, but it's obvious that it, you know, he had him, the drug dealer had him killed. So, or he would steal, you know, drug money. If somebody had a big bag of money, he'd go in there and pull some out. Or there's stories where he took the whole thing, and we'll get into some of those specifics on those stories. But before we get to that, and again, that's the main focus, I want to talk a little about some other cops that I had found some information on. And again, I didn't find a lot. And you hear it, I think most of them aren't big stories, because even in Las Vegas, you know, I heard about cops that sexually assaulted women, cops that were caught doing drugs, which the only problem I have with cops doing drugs is hypocrisy. And even him selling drugs is the hypocrisy of it. Didn't seem like he was arresting drug dealers, though, anyway. And if he was, it wasn't many. It was busting drug dealers so they wouldn't to help out the one that he was working for. But the hypocrisy is what bothers me. I have no problems with cops selling drugs if they weren't cops, or if drugs were legal and they weren't arresting people for doing them, or doing drugs. I don't have a problem with that neither. The problem is the hypocrisy, or driving drunk. It's the hypocrisy factor. And they did all of those things. So one of the group of cops, this was a group of cops, and I'm sorry, I said the 70 under investigation and 30 left. That was actually in LA. I think there were more at the 175, and I have that somewhere. There are 100 investigated, I think, at the 175. I have from the three that I'm going to talk about again, there's a couple more, but I'm not going to say a lot about them. There ended up being big investigations after that at the precincts they were at. So the most recent I found actually went to jail in 2000. So there was a cop in L.A. that worked for the LAPD. He was a former, I believe, Marine. He was in the military. He ended up working for Crash, which, if you've seen the movie Colors, that was the group they were a part of. And I don't know how much that was based on the actual Crash unit in Colors. But if you've seen Colors, that's what they were. They were working for Crash, which is the gang unit. I forget what it stands for, but it's something with, you know, gangs. So he left the Marines. And again, I believe it was the Marines. I know he was in the military. I'm almost 99% positive it was the Marines. And always wanted to be a cop. So this is a guy who talks about, his name was Rafael Perez. He talked about, he was from, he moved around a lot, but ended up growing up in somewhere in Philly. He moves to Maine again, I think, in the Marines. It was either the Marines or the Air Force. gets married, but always wanted to become a cop, grew up watching like Chips and there was some other show or something, and he wanted to help people. So they interviewed his there was a documentary on him in Busted, which I think is from the History Channel or National Geographic, and you can find it on YouTube. Just type in Rafael Perez, LAPD, and you'll probably be able to find it. But he, at least to his first wife, you know, she totally said that, you know, it shocked her. It surprised her that what he ended up doing. And this was a guy that did both sides, where he would steal from people. He would, you know, shake down gang members. They had an interview with a couple gang members that he framed. He would just violate people's rights all the time. And so he wasn't just corrupt. I mean, this guy was a fucked up guy. He's definitely, at least from what I was able to obtain, and I'm sure there's other cops out there that, you know, I only wanted to get so many. I mean, I only have so much time in the show. But he is definitely the worst of what I found cop-wise, because he was on both sides as far as where I'm talking about the cop that will violate your rights and the cop that also will commit crimes, like literal. I mean, it's a crime to violate your rights, but, you know, actual crimes that they arrest people for. So he was dealing drugs. He got involved with a guy named David Mack, who was from South Central. And you see how, and this is something that the guy from the Detroit Threat Management Center had told me. And his name's escaping me right now. But he had told me that a lot of these guys were basically criminals that became cops. And you think about it, it's like government. You want power. You want to legally be able to do all these things, become a cop or become a politician. Or it's, if you had ever listened to the clip that I play that talks about libertarians and how, you know, going from no government to a government and how the people that are the criminals end up forming the government and take it over so they can legally oppress people. It's the same type of rationale. So this guy was from South Central, basically a criminal who became a cop. And he did a robbery where he stole $700,000, ended up getting arrested for it, went to jail. So, but Rafael Perez looked up to this guy, and maybe that's what corrupted him. I don't know. But they ended up getting him on stealing 8 pounds of cocaine. And that's what he was convicted on. I believe he got 8 years because I think he cooperated in some way. I don't know if he gave names, but after that, there was an investigation where there were 70 officers under investigation and 30 had left from the LAPD. And this was 1999, 2000. And the LAPD, you look at all the scandals that they have had, going all the way back to the movie L.A. Confidential. It's supposed to be based on a true story where when Mickey Cohen went to jail, that they were trying to take over, you know, even the drug rackets in L.A. and that the department was corrupt. And when we talk about Michael Dowd, I mean, you can understand where he's coming from to an extent. And we'll get into that. So at the time he was making, you know, between $28,000 and $36,000 a year, and, you know, seeing all these other ways to make money. And it's like, you know, you could see how people can be tempted, and to give them that power, and you're putting them in positions where you're giving them that power. And that's a lot of the problem. But we'll get back to that. So Rafael Perez, I believe he was sentenced to 8 years. And luckily, the drug dealers that he framed, I believe he came out and they gave, I think that was part of his deal, and he was able to get less time because he came out and said, you know, these guys were framed and they had gotten out of jail. He framed some gang members. And the laws in California, and I meant to look these up again, I read them years ago, but there are like laws, if you're labeled a gang member, it's totally unconstitutional, the shit that they do. But who cares? I mean, of course, the government breaks the Constitution all the time. But if you're labeled a gang member, it's just ridiculous the way you are treated. And not necessarily every gang member is a criminal. Now, of course, that's what they want you to think. And there are a lot of gang members that are criminals and are killing people. And the other, the selling drugs part, again, is not a crime to me as far as I'm concerned. But if you're doing drive-bys and killing people, but I don't believe every fucking gang member is killing people at all. You know, maybe there's a lot that get in a fight with rival gangs and stuff like that. But this whole thing that, you know, every gang member is a criminal, I don't believe that, because that's what media, of course, wants you to think and whatever. So, and they highlight that and they show the negative side. I'm not saying join a gang and that being a gang member is a positive thing. It's not. But you, just because you're in a gang does not mean you give up all your rights. And I'm talking about even gang members that haven't been arrested. And the guys that were framed were two gang members that actually had never been arrested. The ones that actually got released and came out in the documentary and talked about how they were framed. And obviously they were, because he had come out later when he was being sentenced and admitted that they were framed. So you see in this scenario, I mean, these two guys that were partners, both of them end up in jail. And how he really, this was something that, and I didn't do any additional research, because this is something that, you know, the main focus is Michael Dowd, and I have a lot of information on him, but I wanted to mention some other people as well, so you know that this is going on. And however much it's going on that we hear about, you know, who knows how much it's going on in reality, and people are getting away with it, because I'm sure a lot of cops are getting away with it. Cops protect each other's backs and that whole thing. And if you don't, you know, you're considered bad or a snitch, or look at Frank Serbico. So and we'll go into him in a second. But I guess after that, there was a big investigation. Supposedly, yeah, they cleaned everything up. The problem is that it's not the people, it's the institution. It's the same with government. It's not the people, it's the institution. And no matter what people say, and they could say whatever they want, that, oh, yeah, if we get the right people in there, there's so many people that still believe that things can be fixed from the system. And if you get the right people in there, that you can actually have freedom with government. And I don't, because it's just, it gets more and more corrupt because of the institution. So even people that go in with the intention of doing something good end up getting corrupted. And that's the only thing, at least from the information I got, that I can explain here what happened with this guy. So, but who knows what really goes through people's heads? I mean, you don't really know. So supposedly the LAPD is all cleaned up now, right? Yeah. So Frank Serbico, those that don't know anything about Frank Serbico, which most people do, they made a movie in the 70s about him. Al Pacino played him. So if you haven't seen Serbico, definitely pick up a copy of that. He was essentially the only good cop in a sea of corrupt cops. And I'm not talking about necessarily cops that were beating people up and violating people's rights, although I bet they did that too. But I mean, he wouldn't take payoffs. He wouldn't do criminal acts. He wouldn't participate in any of that. And for that, he got shot in the face. He had said that something like 90-something percent of the department was, you know, corrupt in New York. And, you know, of course, Michael Dowd comes out and he's the one from the 175 that the documentary was based on and said, well, most cops are good and whatnot. To me, something like that, I give him a lot less credibility, you know, even though he's been honest about the things that he did, because he never said anything about any other cops. So, of course, he's going to say that. But then he talks about, you know, cops need to know you're good. They need to know that you can do things and they're not going to tell on you. So, I mean, he kind of contradicts what he says anyway. Now, I believe more of Serbico, who had no reason to really lie in that situation. And he basically brought down the whole New York City police. I mean, the which I believe is the biggest police department. It's got to be for a city in the world. I had mentioned that before. I've never, you know, looked that up, but I know in the United States, New York City being the biggest city. So, but I would think even the world, and the corruption was just terrible. And I should have got some clips of Serbico. But that's really to summarize what happened with him. Also in New York, I wanted to mention this. There was who they call the cannibal cop. Now, this whole thing is really weird, and you probably have heard about it, that there was a cop, although they made it sound a lot different in the media than the reality. The reality of this cop was that he would only online talk about eating women and planning to do all this stuff to them and then eat them. And it was very fucked up, but at the same time, he never acted on it or did anything other than talk on the internet about it to people he didn't even know in a fetish chat room. And he ended up getting a hung jury. The last I had heard is that they appealed and the judge affirmed. So what happened was, no, sorry, he got convicted. The judge overturned it. It got sent. They appealed to another judge. He affirmed it. And that was in December, I believe, of 2015. And that's the last I know. They could appeal to the Supreme Court, which shouldn't even take the case, to be honest, because it's really a free, I believe that it's a free speech case. So I don't believe this guy is a criminal or corrupt cop, but the fact that you had a cop who was kind of engaging in this behavior online is a little scary, although he never did anything to act on it. Never even, you know, remotely to think that he was going to go through it, through with it. So it comes down to, you know, what can you say? And, you know, what about people that write sick horror stories, you know? And he did have a list of actual people, and I think that's what got him into trouble. And he looked up some of those people in the police database, and which was violating their rights or violating his oath or whatnot. It wasn't legal for him to do that, but I'm sure police use police databases for all the shit. The NSA was looking up, you know, their girlfriends and shit and stuff like that, and nothing happens to them. That's okay. So he did do that, but it wasn't around the same time that he had talked about, you know, the eating stuff. They showed some of the text of what he was saying, and it was just fucked up. But again, that was, you know, it was a fantasy of him talking to people about it. So I think if it does go to the Supreme Court, it's actually an important case about freedom of speech, really. The other ones I wanted to just mention is the whole San Diego Police Department had a sexual assault scandal where they were investigated for. The New Orleans Police Department was, from what I understand, totally out of control, working for drug dealers and selling drugs, and they were investigated. Even Las Vegas, but for a different reason. Las Vegas and Albuquerque recently were investigated by the Justice Department, but that was more for shootings and violating people's rights, not criminal. Even though it's criminal what they're doing, but not an actual something that's a criminal statute for other people that aren't police. So they were investigated for that, but these departments were actually investigated for more of actual crimes. There were two Chicago cops, and there was one that they said was tied to the mob. He was tried. He was tried when he was 70 or 80. Bill Hanhart was allegedly a crooked Chicago cop tied to the mob. There was another cop in Chicago that would torture people to confess to crimes. John Burge did planting of guns and drugs. And then the other big one, which in a way was connected because the people, I think, were connected to each other, meaning the drug dealers may have been connected to each other, or the drugs may have went there first, was the riverboat cops in Miami. So I'm going to take a quick break. Then when we come back, and I'll play some stuff from Michael Dowd. We'll talk about the riverboat cops in Miami, and then we'll get into Michael Dowd and his story and how he feels now about what he did, along with all of the crazy stuff that he had done and got away with for years. He was a cop for 10 years. He even wanted to get out of it and draw, I think, psych pension. And they gave him back his gun. And he's like, what the fuck? I'm under investigation for 15 complaints. And they're, you know, still putting me out there. So that kind of says a lot right there. So anyway, if you'd like to call in, 702-470-7664. 702-470-7664 or username NonPartisanLibertyForAll on Skype. And check us out at NonPartisanLibertyForAll.com. There's also a donate button there if you'd like to donate. I don't expect anybody to, but we don't make any money from the show, nor have I in the 2+ years that I've been doing the show. Everything that I've gotten, all the equipment, all the fees I pay every month are all things that I fund through my day job. So if you'd like to donate, that's great. If not, you know, that's fine too. I know you have these people that yell about, you owe me money, because if you listen to my show and I put it on and you should give me money. No, I don't. You know, I'm doing a show because I feel like doing a show and that's what I want to do. And if you feel that you're getting something out of it and you have money to give and you feel like giving me money, then that's fine. And if you don't, then hey, that's fine too. So anyway, we'll be right back. NonPartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Tune in to the Greenlight NYC show.
Dominican gang. $24,000 in our hands to talk.
Mike was a rain. Say no problem.
In his business, if you mess up, you got killed.
The notorious Michael gangster cop, ex-cop, damn. Michael Dowd in the building, man.
In the house, thanks.
Like, just give me a quick bio on you for people that don't know that much. Let's go through it real quick.
All right, you know, I'm a 55-year-old man today, so I'm not the guy I was in 1980s when I like to look at it like when we survived. You know, guys from my genre, we survived the 80s, you know. I was a young guy. I became a cop. It was a good job.
So you started being a police officer with great intentions, you know, to protect the community and to help others. How did that transition happen for you?
Well, I mean, you know, you start out with altruistic values like anybody, you know. You want to do a job, you know. You get hired, you're excited. And then, you know, what happens is you go down a slippery slope. You begin to take steps that may be
unethical.
Yeah, we'll go with unethical.
Wait, let's talk about before the incarceration. You, there's a lot of different stories. There's stories that you were involved with the A-team from Brooklyn, such as guys like King Tut, you know, Haitian Jack, and a lot of these other guys that came up early 90s.
Yeah, well, being involved is a little slightly different.
You know? I mean, I heard stories that you would, like, give, like, you were looking out. Like, you giving guys, like, the eye up, like, yo, you might get raided, you know, today.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, well, you know, Tut was a different player, you know? He was really...
For those that don't know, Tut was the guy that shot Tupac.
Right.
Okay, yeah. For those that don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
So now listen to this. I'm curious because when you first started, there wasn't a war on drugs.
No, there wasn't.
And then eventually through your time being an officer, that policy was implemented.
Right.
How did that drastically change your position?
Well, see, part of the war on drugs is the New York City Police Department didn't get that memo. Like, we weren't allowed to arrest drug dealers because it would cost the city a lot of fucking money. So they were like, chill. You know, every time you locked up a little guy for a couple dimes, nickels, whatever they had, crack, you know, pieces, they would get upset because it cost them the cops overtime, the cost of jailing them, the cost of the courts, the cost of a lawyer. And they were out before you were out with the paperwork. So
let's talk about that. How are you getting paid?
No, because I said, you got to look at it like this. I'm getting accused of taking shit by people because I'm not making arrests and these guys are still on the corner the next minute. So instead of being pointed fingers at, like, you guys ain't doing nothing, you know, we started to do something. We got paid. So I would tax the guy on it. Whatever corner I got the call on, I would tax.
Now, at a specific time, I know that you were selling drugs. You were dealing with drug dealers.
Right.
You were like, you were just basically a criminal. You was just basically a gangster.
Yeah, sure.
Right?
We don't deny that at some point. My career went full circle.
My question is, why wasn't it ever directed towards the mafia? It was always like the hood, like the crack
in the
hood. That's
what you in the hood. What are you gonna do? You know, when you're in an Italian neighborhood, you work with mobsters.
Yeah.
When you're in an urban black Spanish neighborhood, you work with the crack dealers, whoever they got.
And this was in East New York. This was in East New York, right?
Whoever's getting paid, that's who you're working with. I don't give a shit what neighborhood. The Irish neighborhood, you work with the Westies. I don't fucking care. Whoever's paying.
Yeah.
I was approached by Internal Affairs in the New York City Police Department approximately a year ago or so. In order to help them put together a couple of films so that they could show some real live character in what it is and how corruption begins and what it turns into.
Exactly.
And then the end result. So, in other words, it's like if you want to go to AA, you're not going to listen to a guy who read about getting sober in a book.
How do people receive you when you're giving that advice?
Well, a lot of the cops don't like
me,
okay?
Uh-huh.
Let's keep it real. Because and they really, maybe they shouldn't like
the cops
me.
Must hate you.
Well, what it is it's twofold. One thing is I give them some respect in a way because people actually, when they see some of the shit that went on in that documentary, it actually shows people what the cops lived in. Don't get me wrong. The choices that I made weren't right, but it gives the people a basis to see how the cops in the 80s, early 90s had to survive. Listen, when crack hit New York City, it was like Hurricane Sandy coming up the fucking coast, man.
Definitely.
It just, boom, it leveled everybody. And we're human beings. We're all susceptible to
were you getting high at this time? Were you doing drugs as well?
At some point, yeah.
So what are you doing, like, as far as, like, to, like, secure some kind of, like, rights towards your story now?
Yeah.
I'm sure your story needs to get told.
No, but like you said, we did the documentary,
yeah.
and my life rights were sold to Sony, and Sony
okay.
owns it, and Sony and I are just wrestling over a few numbers right now, but
okay,
yeah, it's on.
Who would you want to play you?
You know, they ask that question a lot, and the director of the movie wants me to say Tom Hardy, but... You know, Mark Wahlberg is fighting with everybody.
I like that.
That he wants to play me.
Yes.
So it's a tussle right now.
I came into this interview thinking one thing about him and came out thinking something, knowing something totally different. You know what I mean?
I hope it's better.
Salute to you, the crazy caller. What was his name? Mimi or something
M-E-E?
Man, listen. Be careful, man. You had these internet bloggers and stuff, you know, their thumbs are harder than anything else in the world.
Yeah, whatever. Listen, forget about it. Everybody should just get along in this world, like Rodney King said, right? Why can't we all just get along?
Straight up, let's get back to the music right now. DJ Instincts, Wahida, the Tsunami Team, we want to...
New York is in the grips of a crime wave.
It was like the heyday of crack.
It was violent, man.
Homicides, robberies, rapes. It was a war zone.
East New York, Brooklyn, 75 precinct, the deadliest precinct in the country. Who did I burn to get put here? It would scare Clint Eastwood.
When I first went to the precinct, I hear about this guy, Mike Dowd.
Mikey's just crazy.
Michael Dowd was a crook who ended up wearing a cop's uniform.
He was a criminal.
Once in a generation, corrupt cop.
I consider myself both a cop and a gangster.
Forget about Beverly Hills and all that other stuff. The ghetto is one of the richest neighborhoods there is.
Maybe there's some way we can make money from this.
La Compañía. It's a very serious Dominican gang.
$24,000 in our hands to talk.
Mike was of rain. Say no problem.
In his business, if you mess up, you got killed.
I'm a New York City cop. I'm taking a risk of going to jail for a long period of time, and you're gonna short me a dime?
His word against mine. And I'm a cop. I'd break a neck if your neck needs a breaking.
I had 3 machines counting money, and it's still not enough time.
Everybody on the floor now.
There's no becoming a cop again.
You're gonna have me killed.
We knew we were up against a really tough crew.
A month ago, I was a regular cop, and now I'm a criminal.
That's what they taught us in the police academy. Got a guy in the front, guy in the back, got an entry team.
You felt like you were God.
The normal person that's doing wrong is going to have a fear of being caught.
I never had a fear about getting busted.
Michael Dowd did not have any fear.
Because the cops around me would never give me up.
Here's a text from, I assume, a new police officer. What do you tell new police officers so that this doesn't happen to
them?
Good
question. I'm glad there's a new police officer that wants to hear it rather than some old crotchety guy who's mad.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, what I would say is this, and this is how I try to explain to people when I go into a speaking engagement. I say, look, remember that what you're doing, if you're going to do something corrupt, it's not your partner you're hurting. It's the police department and his family you're going to destroy.
Yeah.
Because really, the destruction that took place in our lives, it's more than ourselves. Because oftentimes, if I get hurt, if I get in trouble, it's not you. So when you think you're going to do something corrupt and go over the line as a cop and you're asking your partner to co-sign to that, what you're doing is you're potentially destroying his family. So how much do you really love him? Because you guys got to love each other to work together. You have to. There's got to be a love. There's got to be a bond stronger than a marriage because you got each other's back, 24/7. So if you're willing to take this guy away from his wife and kids or his family or his mother or his dad, whatever he or she is involved with, then how much do you really love this guy?
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
And we are back. So that was just a few clips, including the actual promo to the documentary, which it may be on Netflix or Amazon Prime, but it's on one of the cable channels now, and that's where I saw it. I don't remember which one, but if you have all the movie channels and pay a ridiculous amount for your cable like I do, you'll probably be able to find it that way. But before we get into that, I just want to briefly talk about the Miami riverboat cops. And I never realized until I had started doing research on drugs and Pablo Escobar and these things, how bad Miami got in the 80s. It seemed like New York and Miami were the worst two places throughout the 80s. At different times, I think later in the 80s is when Miami had the highest murder rate. I don't know about New York. I'd have to go back and look. But I know that Miami, at certain points in the 80s, had the highest murder rate. I was really young, so not being aware of things like that. And I do remember Miami Vice, but I didn't think that all of the stuff that was going on. I mean, I saw the show when I was a kid and didn't know what was going on in Miami with the cocaine trade and all of the murders because of that. I mean, there were shootouts in the malls. And one of the people, and this has nothing to do with what I'm going to talk about, the riverboat cops, but was this female, basically, lunatic who ended up getting killed, and she was from Medellin, Colombia. I can't think of her name right now. Griselda, I can't remember her last name at the moment, but she kind of ran Miami, and she was getting all her coke from Colombia, as a lot of people were back then. And from what I understand now, the Dominican Republic is a big place where people are getting coke from. I don't think they're growing it there, but it may be coming from, I believe, Peru to the Dominican Republic to, say, New York and places like that, at least in the Nat Geo documentaries on drugs. But because I think so much cocaine went through Florida, because obviously it's the easiest way to get it to the United States was Florida if it's coming from South America. And then And of course, now you have Mexico as well, as bigger than, you know, the Dominican Republic and Colombia, as far as the cartels. But that you had all when Castro released over 100,000 Cuban refugees and 10% of them were criminals as well. So what happened was in Miami, all of a sudden they had this influx of a huge amount of people, and 10% being criminals is a lot. Well, I guess 10% of 100,000 is what, I mean, that's, it was over 100,000. So over 1,000, you know, people that came from jail. That doesn't mean that they're going to start criminal activities when they get to the U.S., but that's what Scarface was kind of based on, when all of the Cuban immigrants and the ones that were released from jail just to get rid of them and dump them on the U.S. So that's what Tony Montana's character was. He was in jail in Cuba and was one of those political refugees that was released. If you remember, people that saw Scarface, I'm sure most people have in the beginning, and they ask him about his tattoo on his hand. So just briefly, from what I understand, and Michael Dowd had mentioned something about the Miami crews being the ones who at times had robbed the guy that they were protecting. In one of the interviews, he didn't go into any detail, but he had mentioned that. But anyway, there were a bunch of corrupt cops that were robbing drug dealers. And at first, they thought it was fake or criminals dressed up as cops, so that it was fake, you know, fake cops robbing these drug dealers. And in the way that it really started, and this is why I guess they call them the riverboat cops, is they found three bodies in the ocean somewhere, I guess. And they had, you know, money and I believe guns, you know, designer jeans. I mean, they were drug dealers, and there were ways that they figured out they were drug dealers, you know, lots of money, like I said, they had guns, designer jeans, stuff like that. So what they found out at the end that had happened, maybe I should just get to not kind of ruin the story, I guess. Anyway, so that's how it started, this investigation. And there was this special unit. I forget the name of this special unit that investigated it. But anyway, they thought the same thing initially, because they had reported, hey, these guys, you know, dressed up as cops robbed us. But it was real cops. And what they did was, as I had mentioned, you know, one of the I don't know if he was a former cop or FBI or whatnot, had mentioned that when they hired all these cops, you know, they really just hired more for quantity than quality. And they were hiring, you know, a lot of Cuban cops, and they were hiring cops not really based on high enough criteria, that they're just, hey, we have this influx of over 100,000 people. We need to hire a certain amount of police to now police the city, and especially with what's the release of, you know, some of these prisoners. And I guess they didn't know which were criminals and which weren't, obviously. And not only that, but just the cocaine trade that started to happen as well, and start going through Miami. So, and with Griselda, again, I can't remember her last name, and she was the subject of Cocaine Cowboys 2, part two, where she was in jail and a drug dealer actually called her and started getting advice from her. And then I guess they were sort of dating. And then she finally got out of jail, I believe, 2008, and then was killed in Medellin, because she was deported right away, got killed in Medellin, Colombia, I think, in 2012. But she was a straight-up murderer. She had so many people murdered. She had a crazy temper. But the way she grew up was just bad. She was a prostitute for a while. She ran away from home. I think she might have ran away from an orphanage. I don't remember, but it was 15 or 16, and she had a hard life. Now, that doesn't mean – and they called her the Black Widow, I believe, because all her husbands – she killed them, I think, most of them. Or had them killed. So she, I mean, had these assassins that just killed so many people, and a lot of those killings, and it being the city with the highest murder rate in the 80s was because of her, along with, you know, just the cocaine trade. But so they brought in a special unit, and they figured out that it was actually cops. And I believe it was 10, 17 officers ended up being arrested in that. But what they did was they got information from an informant, who a drug dealer who actually got robbed, who was willing to say, yeah, I was buying cocaine. I'm sure they gave him immunity, hopefully, for that. And then one of the officers that was, I don't think he was part of his team, but he knew. So he had gave information, and then they actually paid someone to put out a hit on him, and the guy just took the money and left. And the first jury was actually a hung jury. They were able to convince a jury to get a hung jury, but the investigator said that was actually better for them. It gave them more time to collect information, and they ended up convicting, I believe, 17 officers. And then they, after that, investigated about 100 and tried to get rid of all the corrupt cops in Miami. Of course, I doubt that happened, but they at least got rid of those cops who were robbing drug dealers. And what happened was, with the guys that were found in the water, they had drowned. So that's why it was a weird thing. So if that hadn't happened, they probably would have went on for a while longer. But what happened was, they robbed drug dealers on a boat, and I guess there were 6 of them, and they, you know, threw them off or pulled guns on them and told them to get off. They weren't trying to kill anybody. So 3 of them, maybe they couldn't have swim, drowned. And those were the 3 that they found. And the other 3, I guess, were able to swim to safety. And what are they going to do? Say, yeah, we got robbed for our coke? No. So that's what happened. But that resulted in, they would have been better off if they probably killed them and buried them. That's what resulted in them finding out about these officers. And the reason I'm kind of just going through some of these is, these are just examples of cops that are criminals. And there's plenty of them. This is not just, oh, there's just a couple. So, I mean, for every one that you hear about, and you don't hear about that many, and I'm sure the departments try to keep it under wraps as much as possible, but I'm sure there's tons of them that don't get caught, that do, you know, and there's levels of what they do. Now, what these cops did was pretty bad. What the LAPD cop, Rafael Perez, it was definitely the worst that I had brought up, at least on the information that I got. But I mean, how many of these do you have? But then the whole department ends up getting investigated, and then they find like half the department is fucking corrupt. You know, and you have, I mentioned the whole San Diego Police Department with sexual assault, the New Orleans Police Department, and this is with, you know, corruption. So not only do you have the violations of rights and the cops shooting and killing people, you have that corruption side. So how prevalent is it now? Because most of these are from a while ago. I'm sure that it's probably more. We're just not hearing about it. They're keeping it, you know, to themselves, and they're being more careful, and they're, you know, keeping the public more, I think, looking at them killing people by using excessive force. We're looking more at that than stuff like this anyway. So it's almost a perfect time for them to do stuff like that, although there's more cameras now, there's more surveillance, there's more stuff like that. But it's probably a better time because it's not really being looked at. You know, and I've seen stories of, not in mainstream government media, but on, you know, independent media that does follow the stuff about cops being arrested for drugs, cops being arrested for beating their wives, a lot of stuff like that, but never excessive force or violating people's rights or whatever. And not a lot of stuff like this where the whole department's corrupt. But that doesn't mean it's not going on. And I think it probably is going on more. It's just they're doing a better job, you know, with the public and what they're looking at. And if you have internal affairs looking more at one thing than something else, they're looking more at the violation of rights than cops being corrupt, which they may be looking at it, but they're not doing anything about it. You know, that may factor into it as well. So this is just another strike against the police. And these are just examples to show how fucked up police are, is what it is. So with Michael Dowd, he did this documentary. He's been out of jail 12 years or 11 years, and he served 12 years. I think he's been out like 11 years and served 12 years, or it might be around the same that he's been out 12 years and he served 12 years. I know he served 12 years. And he's been out now 10 plus years, we'll say. So he became a cop right out of high school, essentially. It was his first job. And I guess that's how they were hiring people. They would take the civil service exam. In a way, it's a positive thing because, you know, you don't have to. It was a blue collar job for people. But at the same time, you didn't get the money. Like the Las Vegas Police Department, their patrolmen are making, you know, $80,000-$90,000 a year, which is ridiculous based on the service you get from them. Now, if you were getting, you know, the service you should get, I don't have a problem with that because the more you pay them, the less apt they are to do something to mess that up. But really, anything, you know, that has to do with violating people's rights or excessive force isn't going to mess that up anyway. So, but back then, and I don't know what he started in 82, and I think he started at 28,000, and at some point he was making 36. Now, I don't know what the equivalent of that is now. And maybe there's a calculator somewhere, you know, because that may be 50, 60,000 now. I don't know. But either way, the amount of money that he had access to was, you know, his whole year's salary in a day. It got ridiculous. So he started out, he wasn't sure. He said, like, kind of right out of high school, but, you know, around 21. But then he said kind of, I think he actually started as a cop by himself at 21. And then first he went through the academy, and then he went out with somebody else for a year, and then finally he's by himself. And, you know, in that, like I said, there's one positive side, but I'd rather cops that are college educated just to have that experience. The whole thing of having a 19, 20-year-old kid pull you over and try to fucking lecture you. And he didn't seem to be that type of person, but I mean, those were what they were hiring that age, because there were other cops too. I mean, they're hiring kids essentially, and giving them that power and giving them, you know, the ability to do these things like pull people over. And how many times, you know, anyone that's been pulled over, and I haven't been pulled over that many times, but the cops try to lecture you or try to give you an attitude and try to act like, you know, hey, some 20-year-old is what the fuck do they know, you know? And so for me, although back then you could say, well, it's good because it's a job somebody can get, they didn't have to go to college, and it was a good blue collar job. Because he had said it was a good job, it just wasn't a lot of money. But again, I don't know how much that was now. We'll say it's got to be at least double, I would think, at least. So, you know, if you consider it at least double, I mean, 70,000, looking at the 36, that's pretty good. I mean, that's what they're making now, or more in Vegas. But in New York, and it may be more, you know, New York, obviously higher cost of living, but I don't know about what it was then. So that's something I'd have to look at. But it's still not a lot of money compared to being able to get paid $4,000 a week, which he ended up getting just for protecting a drug dealer. So we'll get into that. But I think that cops need some life experience. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't be, you know, in your 20s and be a cop, but you should definitely, there should be a requirement of having a college degree. And maybe if they did that, they wouldn't get cops. Of course, they're trying to hire cops with lower IQs as well, so they're obedient. But I don't believe you need a college degree to be a cop, but you should need something, maybe at least an associate's or whatever. But they send them to the police, or the police academy should be those types of programs, like a criminal justice degree, an associate's in criminal justice, while you're going through the academy, that it gives you that type of education at the same time. But it was, he said, almost 6 months at the academy, as I've said. And then, you know, he said he was in the second tier. So even though you go out with somebody for a year, he had to wait. So he was basically out by himself. And his first really taking of money, which was pretty quick, really, once he got to that point after, you know, the academy and the year, he pulled somebody over who had no plates, no license, no nothing, but had, you know, like $2,000 in their pocket, and told him, you know, you buy me a nice lobster lunch or something. So he left him a couple $100 on the seat and he let him go. And he was nervous about that, but that was his first kind of, you know, thing. He also talked about, you know, in the police academy, the instructors were really, internal affairs came in there and talked to them, but the instructors really had the attitude of, you know, you can go this way or that way, but basically cover your ass, whatever you do. And that you have to, these are his words, that you have to prove that you're good to your partners. And being good means that you don't snitch on cops, which I don't call that being a snitch. He calls Serbico a snitch and actually kind of said some bad things about him. Because you think about it, snitching is telling the cops about bad things people are doing. When you tell on the authorities, you're like a whistleblower, not a snitch. It's a totally different thing to me. So, I mean, that's what they call it. And he still says that. And again, people that are interviewing him, you know, are treating him like he's this great guy. And he is a likable guy, I have to say. And he has interesting stories. And from the how he treated people side as a cop, and he says, you know, how good a cop he was, at least from what he said, and I said this earlier, it doesn't seem like he was bad to people, like he was violating people's rights and he was fucking people over, you know, and he said they weren't arresting people for drugs, they weren't doing a lot of stuff like that. So, you know, he didn't really fuck with anybody except people he called criminals. He talked about running into one of the fat boys, Prince Marky D, and caught him with a gun. And I guess the guy he was with at the time said, oh, we can't arrest him because he's friends with my brother, or my brother's friends with him, or something like that. So they actually didn't end up arresting him. But he started with that. And then, you know, he lived by that code that you don't snitch on police. Although he said that he did it once because he said, OK, I'm going to go straight. And he told on this one guy and he hated how it felt. And that was it. And then people didn't want to work with him because of that. Because then they thought he was a snitch and he actually told on nobody. When he testified in front of this committee, and they show parts of it in the documentary, and some of the documentary is not true the way they cut it. And so I would, if you want to learn more information, there's a lot of interviews out there, podcasts that have interviewed him. So I found them on YouTube, Joe Rogan. This guy who I think is terrible as a podcaster, Joey Diaz, but he was on there for a while, like a couple hours. Even Howard Stern interviewed him. So I didn't realize how popular he was, and that happens a lot. Just like I talked about that show on Netflix, the guy who was framed for murder and then not framed, but arrested for murder and wrongly convicted, and DNA let him out. And then a couple years later, they convicted him of murdering somebody else, and he still says he's innocent. But because I usually don't do shows on stuff that everybody else is covering, but I guess this is more, you know, the internet. I don't know if he appeared on any mainstream shows or anything like that, but he was on a bunch of podcasts. And well, Howard Stern, I would call like more mainstream, definitely from a popularity standpoint. So he goes and ends up meeting a guy who owns a stereo place but does installations for drug dealers, basically, because the area he's in. And he hooks him up with this first drug dealer who rips him off $700. And he finds him, basically threatens to have a shootout with him, and because he puts a hit out on him. And the drug dealer puts a hit out on him, and he calls off the hit and gives him back his money, and he says, fuck that, and they're not going to work with that guy anymore. Now, in between this, he's stealing money anytime he can. So if they're going to a drug dealer's house, they mentioned there was a guy who had a big thing of weed, like a big fucking canister, and had a bag of money. And of course, they take the money. It was like 20 grand. And that's more than half your salary. So imagine, you're collecting that, or, drug dealers are keeping cash. So anytime they find bags of money, there was another instance where I think it was like 50 grand or something like that, where he couldn't take it because there were other cops around. But he got a friend of his that was a former cop. Because what happened was the 177, I guess, which is pretty close to the 175, a bunch of cops got busted there for corruption. So what happened was after that, his partner at the time had left. A bunch of people left because they said, hey, we don't want to end up getting investigated. We don't want any of this. We're out. After the 177 went down, I guess. But Michael Dowd said, fuck it. The last thing they want is another big, investigation and embarrassment of another, I don't know what they would call them, stations or departments. I mean, they're all around the city based on, the areas. So he stayed there. So one of the guys that was, I think, his former partner, he had called him. He circled around the place, he said, like 40 times. And the woman who happened to be with him that day, because his regular partner, I think, there was something, maybe he was I'm thinking he was at the doctor's or hospital. Or, I don't know. He wasn't there. So he called this guy. They went in like they were fake cops, like they were real cops, but they were fake cops. They took the money and he got about 20 grand out of that. So while they were collecting money from that drug dealer, although they only did it once, he got $8,000 and split it with his partner, so $4,000. But he was taking money anytime he could, or coke. If they went somewhere and found coke, there was one incident where he mentioned a briefcase. He's like, there's got to be, he could tell the houses that were drug houses and the ones that weren't, is what he said. And there was a locked box briefcase, and he's like, there's got to be coke in here. So he somehow got it open and got, coke out of there. And he would take, drugs or money, and from obviously, drug dealers. And what happened was the guy from the stereo shop, his name was, I always want to say Baron Davis, but that's a basketball player, Baron Perez. He hooked him up with this other guy, Adam Diaz. They're both Dominican. And there was $24,000 just to talk to him. So he got $24,000 for that. I'm sure he split it with his partner. And then same thing, $8,000 a week he'd split with his partner. So $4,000 a week. So, again, at the time, I think he was making $36,000. So you look at that in what? If you're making $36,000 almost in 2 months, you've almost made 2 months in a week, you made your year salary already. And that's just from that. Never mind, anytime you get a chance to take money, he would take money. And there's so many things that he didn't even get to talk about in the interviews and the documentary. But he became really part of this guy, Adam Diaz's crew. He'd warn them if the police were going to raid him. He'd raid other people for him. go after other drug dealers for him, try to shut them down if he could, do things like that. And then he was doing all this coke himself. The guy bought a Corvette. It's like they all say in the documentary that he just didn't give a fuck about anything. But at the same time, you have all these other cops. And what he was saying, essentially, what I got from it is all these other cops do, maybe they don't go to the extent that he did. But if they have a chance to take some money, or maybe not drugs, but, you know, take money, that they'll do the same thing. And that you feel like you have this power. He talked about, you know, feeling untouchable and powerful, and that he was never going to get caught. And he started selling drugs himself. And of course, if he found drugs in different places, you know, he would go and sell that. So he's making all this money. He said he bought like three houses. He bought a condo in Myrtle Beach, and he had bought a Corvette. Somehow he's getting away with it where the IRS isn't coming after him. He's being investigated by a bunch of different agencies. They're following him around. And he still didn't get caught for about 10 years. He was a cop, and they still wanted him to be a cop. As I was saying earlier, that he wanted to get out of it and collect, like, you know, crazy pension disability or something like that. And they, you know, they gave him back his gun. He said he went away to rehab for a while. And at the end, he ends up getting arrested. He's out on bail. And that was for possession of cocaine. But then his partner ends up setting him up and wearing a wire and distorts what really happened. He made it out to sound like they were going to murder this woman. As really what they were going to do was take money and coke that was owed to a Colombian, I guess, that was living in one of his houses. And from that, he was going to get enough money to take off and not show up for court. So because of his partner wearing a wire and giving them this information, he ends up, you know, getting charged with that too and serving 12 years in jail. And I guess he had talked about not being able to get a job and all of that because he's a felon now. Also, he's a former cop, which makes it even worse. And people feel like they can't trust him. And his attitude is, well, I paid my debt to society. And it's hard to, while watching it, because of his personality, you know, you forget that this guy is a cop, and remember that, and how fucked up, you know, if this was just a guy who did what he did, I wouldn't really, you know, I wouldn't have too many issues. Well, they also did robberies as well, but they were mostly robbing drug dealers. So I wouldn't really, and he didn't kill anybody. So if he did the majority of things that he did and he wasn't a cop, although some of the stuff he wouldn't have been able to do if he wasn't a cop, I wouldn't have really that many issues with the things he did, especially that I think drugs should be legal anyway. So, but you forget that this guy's a cop, and it's like he's being kind of celebrated in these interviews just because he's a likable guy and an interesting storyteller. But this guy was a cop, and then he went, and think about the hypocrisy. I'm sure he did arrest people for drugs. Now, he might have not arrested that many people for drugs, but he's out there being a cop, arresting people for things, And then things that other people would go to jail for, he's getting away with. Now, the other side of that is he did do 12 years in jail. And do I think that's a fair sentence? Probably more than fair, being that, you know, again, he didn't kill anybody really. All he did was sell drugs and take money from drug dealers and rob drug dealers and a lot of that, and sell drugs. A lot of that, again, he wouldn't even have been able to do that if drugs were illegal. But the fact that he was a cop, you can't forget that. And you tend to forget that when you get wrapped up in him as a person. And, you know, the way he tells the stories is funny. And but it's not, though. It's serious. So it's like you kind of get caught up in that. But I would definitely watch the documentary. I thought the documentary was great, even though not all of it is true. He's trying to make a movie about it as well as write a book. And I think it would be a good book. But I don't want to, you know, in a way, I don't want to give this guy any money. I mean, he was a cop. So if you want to be a criminal, be a criminal. But being a cop, like, I don't have a problem with people selling drugs, period, at all. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. But being a cop and doing it, it's that hypocrisy. And I do have a problem with that. And I find myself liking this guy, but then thinking about it and like, wait a minute, I got to take a step back and say what this guy did was fucked up. And it was. And unfortunately, that's all the time we have for tonight. I definitely recommend the 175. You could find it probably in a lot of places, but I did watch it on cable, but it's probably on Netflix or Amazon Prime, or I think you can get it on his website as well. So thanks everybody for listening. I do appreciate it as always, and we will be back on Tuesday. So thanks everybody. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Commands, listen to what we tell you and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.